Macmillan Audio presents The Plot by Jean Hanff Korelitz, read for you by Kirby Heyborne. Good writers borrow, great writers steal. T.S. Eliot, but possibly stolen from Oscar Wilde. Part 1. Chapter 1. Anybody can be a writer. Jacob Finch Bonner, the once promising author of the new and noteworthy, the New York Times Book Review, novel, The Invention of Wonder, let himself into the office he'd been assigned on the second floor of Richard Pang Hall, set his beat-up leather satchel on the barren desk, and looked around in something akin to despair. The office, his fourth home in Richard Pang Hall in as many years, was no great improvement on the earlier three, but at least it overlooked a vaguely collegiate walkway under trees from the window behind the desk, rather than the parking lot of years 2 and 3, or the dumpster of year 1, when, ironically, he'd been much closer to the height of his literary fame, such as it was, and might conceivably have hoped for something nicer. The only thing in the room that signaled anything of an actual literary nature, that signaled anything of any warmth at all, was the beat-up satchel Jake used to transport his laptop, and, on this particular day, the writing samples of his soon-to-arrive students. And this Jake had been carrying around for years. He'd acquired it at a flea market shortly before his first novel's publication with a certain writerly self-consciousness. Acclaimed young novelist still carries the old leather bag he used throughout his years of struggle. Any residual hope of becoming that person now was long gone. And even if it wasn't, there was no way to justify the expense of a new bag. Not any longer. Richard Pang Hall was a 1960s addition to the Ripley campus, an unlovely construction of white cinder block behind the gymnasium and beside some dormitories slapped together for co-eds when Ripley College began admitting women in the year 1966, which, to its credit, had been ahead of the curve. Richard Pang had been an engineering student from Hong Kong, and though he probably owed more of his eventual wealth to the school he'd attended after Ripley College, namely MIT, that institution had declined to construct a Richard Pang Hall, at least for the size of donation he'd had in mind. The Ripley building's original purpose had been to accommodate the engineering program, and it still bore the distinct tang of a science building with its windowed lobby nobody ever sat in, its long, barren corridors, and that soul-killing cinder block. But when Ripley got rid of engineering in 2005, got rid of all its science programs, actually, and all of its social science programs, and dedicated itself, in the words of its frantic board of supervisors, to the study and practice of the arts and humanities in a world that increasingly undervalues and needs them, Richard Pang Hall was reassigned to the low-residency Master of Fine Arts program in fiction, poetry, and personal nonfiction, memoir. Thus had the writers come to Richard Pang Hall on the campus of Ripley College in this strange corner of northern Vermont, close enough to the fabled Northeast Kingdom to bear some trace of its distinct oddness. The area had been home to a small but hardy Christian cult since the 1970s, but not so far from Burlington and Hanover as to be completely in the back of beyond. Of course, creative writing had been taught at the college since the 1950s, but never in any serious, let alone enterprising way. Things got added to the curriculum of every educational institution concerned with survival as the culture changed around it, and as the students began, in their eternally student-y way, to make demands. Women's studies, African American studies, a computer center that actually acknowledged computers were, you know, a thing. But when Ripley underwent its great crisis in the late 1980s, and when the college took a sober and deeply trepidatious look at what might be required for actual institutional survival, it was, surprise, the creative writing that signaled the most optimistic way forward. And so it had launched its first, and still only, graduate program, the Ripley Symposia in Creative Writing. And over the following years, the symposia basically ate up the rest of the college until all that was left was its low residency program, so much more accommodating for students who couldn't drop everything for a 2-year MFA course, and shouldn't be expected to. Writing, according to Ripley's own glossy prospectus and highly enticing website, was not some elitist activity out of bounds to all but the fortunate few. Every single person had a unique voice and a story nobody else could tell. And anybody, especially with the guidance and support of the Ripley Symposia, could be a writer. All Jacob Finch Bonner had ever wanted to be was a writer. Ever, ever, ever. All the way back to suburban Long Island, which was the last place on earth a serious artist of any kind ought to come from, but where he, nonetheless, had been cursed to grow up, the only child of a tax attorney and a high school guidance counselor. Why he'd affixed his star to the forlorn little shelf in his local library marked Authors from Long Island was anyone's guess, but it did not pass unnoticed in the young writer's home. His father, the tax attorney, had been forceful in his objections. Writers didn't make money. Except Sidney Sheldon. Was Jake claiming he was the next Sidney Sheldon? And his mother, the guidance counselor, had seen fit to remind him constantly of his mediocre at best PSAT score on the verbal side. It was greatly embarrassing to Jake that he'd managed to do better on the math than the verbal. These had been grievous challenges to overcome. But what artist was without challenges to overcome? He'd read stubbornly and, it should be noted, already competitively and with envy throughout his childhood, departing the mandatory curriculum, leapfrogging the usual adolescent dross to vet the emerging field of his future rivals. Then off he had gone to Wesleyan to study creative writing, falling in with a tight group of fellow proto-novelists and short story writers who were just as insanely competitive as he was. Many were the dreams of young Jacob Finch Bonner when it came to the fiction he would one day write. The Bonner, in point of fact, wasn't entirely authentic. Jake's paternal great-grandfather had substituted Bonner for Bernstein a solid century before, but neither was the Finch, which Jake himself had added in high school as an homage to the novel that awakened his love of fiction. Sometimes, with books he especially loved, he imagined that he had actually written them himself and was giving interviews about them to critics or reviewers, always humble in his deflection of the interviewer's praise, or reading from them to large, avid audiences in a bookstore or some hall full of occupied seats. He imagined his own photograph on the back jacket flap of a hardcover, taking as his templates the already outdated writer leaning over manual typewriter or writer with pipe, and thought far too often about sitting at a table, signing copies for a long, coiling line of readers. "Thank you," he would intone graciously to each woman or man. "That's so kind of you to say. Yes, that's one of my favorites too." It wasn't precisely true that Jake never thought about the actual writing of his future fictions. He understood that books did not write themselves, and that real work, work of imagination, work of tenacity, work of skill, would be required to bring his own eventual books into the world. He also understood that the field was not uncrowded. A lot of young people just like himself felt the way he did about books and wanted to write them one day, and it was even possible that some of these other young people might conceivably have even more natural talent than he did, or possibly a more robust imagination, or just a greater will to get the job done. These were not ideas that gave him much pleasure, but in his favor, he did know his own mind. He knew that he would not be getting certified to teach English in public schools if the writing thing doesn't work out, or taking the LSATs. Why not? He knew that he had chosen his lane and begun swimming, and he would not stop swimming until he held his own book in his own hands, at which point the world would surely have learned the thing he himself had known for so many years. He was a writer. A great writer. That had been the intention, anyway. It was late June, and it had been raining all over Vermont for the better part of a week when Jake opened the door to his new office in Richard Peng Hall. As he stepped inside, he noticed that he had tracked mud along the corridor and into the room, and he looked down at his sorry running shoes, once white, now brown with damp and dirt, never in fact used for actual running, and felt the pointlessness of taking them off now. He'd spent the long day driving up from the city with two plastic food emporium bags of clothes and that elderly leather satchel containing the nearly as elderly laptop on which his current novel, the novel he was theoretically, as opposed to actually, working on, and the folders of submitted work by his assigned students. And it occurred to him that he had brought progressively less with him each time he'd made the trip north to Ripley. The first year, a big suitcase stuffed with most of his clothing, because who knew what might be considered appropriate attire for 3 weeks in northern Vermont, surrounded by surely fawning students and surely envious fellow teachers? And every printed-out draft of his second novel, the deadline for which he'd had a tendency to whine about in public. This year, only those two plastic bags of tossed-in jeans and shirts and the laptop he now mainly used for ordering dinner and watching YouTube. If he was still doing this depressing job a year from now, he probably wouldn't even bother with the laptop. No. Jake was not looking forward to the about-to-begin session of the Ripley Symposia. He was not looking forward to reconvening with his dreary and annoying colleagues, not one of them a writer he genuinely admired. And certainly he was not looking forward to feigning excitement for another battalion of eager students, each and every one of them likely convinced they would one day write, or perhaps had already written, the great American novel. Most of all, he was not looking forward to pretending that he himself was still a writer, let alone a great one. It went without saying that Jake had not done any preparation for the imminent term of the Ripley Symposia. He was utterly unfamiliar with any of the sample pages in those annoyingly thick folders. When he'd begun at Ripley, he'd persuaded himself that great teacher was a laudable addition to great writer, and he'd given the writing samples of these folks who'd put down real money to study with him some very focused attention. But the folders he was now pulling out of his satchel, folders he ought to have begun reading weeks earlier when they'd arrived from Ruth Steuben, the symposia's highly acerbic office manager, had traveled from priority mailbox to leather satchel without ever once suffering the indignity of being opened, let alone subjected to intimate examination. Jake looked at them balefully now, as if they themselves were responsible for his procrastination and the appalling evening that lay ahead of him as a result. Because after all, What was there to know about the people whose inner lives these folders contained, who were even now converging on northern Vermont and the sterile conference rooms of Richard Pang Hall in this very office, once the one-on-one conferences began in a few days? These particular students, these ardent apprentices, would be utterly indistinguishable from their early.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.